Namaste, dear students of Class 10. I am Tumpuri Srivani from Bharti Vidya Bhavan's BHEL, Arsipuram, Hyderabad. Today, I am going to discuss a topic called The Making of Scientist, written by Robert W. Patterson. And this chapter is taken from your Footprints Without Feet book. Now, let us quickly look at the title, children, The Making of a Scientist. So, as the title is implicating that, this person who went on to become a scientist did not have probably the innate talent by birth. He was made into a scientist probably because of some people who supported him in his life and also because of the hard work and determination, right? So he was made into a scientist. So this helps us understand that any person who is born may not have innate qualities, may not have the talent by birth, but he can still become a scientist with hard work and determination. Okay, so this story is about the life of Richard E. Bright, who went on to become a molecular biologist, and the discoveries which became a feather in his cap were because of certain hobbies which he pursued from childhood. So this chapter also helps us understand why hobbies are important and how hobbies can become driving force in our life to achieve something great, right? So we cannot take hobbies for granted also. So let us quickly read this lesson in detail. At the age of 22, a former scout of the year excited the scientific world with a new theory on how cells work. So here we are talking about this boy who, when turned 22, he was also the scout of the year. That means, children, you all know that scouts usually are very active, not only in studies, but also other activities also. So the scout of the year excited the scientific world with his new theory on how cells work. So this particular boy who was 22 years age, he gave a theory on how cells worked. What is a cell, children? Cell is the smallest unit of a body. So they gave a theory which explained how these cells worked. And Richard E. Bright and his college roommate explained the theory in an article in the Proceedings of the National Academy of Science. So Richard H. E. Bright had a roommate, and both of them actually had written an article in a journal, that is a magazine, okay, magazine kind of thing, or a journal, which is very famous, children. And the name of the journal was Proceedings of the National Academy of Science, so which is very prestigious, that a college going boy's article is published in such a prestigious book. It was the first time this important scientific journal had ever published the work of college students. So it was a feather in the cap of Richard H. Bright's life that his article was published in such a historic book. In sports, that would be like making the big leagues at the age of 15 and hitting a home run your first time at bat. So the author is trying to help us understand how important his achievement was. So he's showing a comparison with the achievement in sports. So achieving this, that is publishing the article in this journal, is just like, it is equivalent to, in sports, it is as if you are playing for big leagues. Big leagues is nothing but, children, the groups of or different teams of various places when they play with each other are called as leagues. And he says at the age of 15, as if you are hitting a home run and it's your first time to bat. So how wonderful that would be. It is similar to publishing the journal in the magazine. For Richard E. Bright, it was the first in a long string of achievements in science and other fields. So all his achievements began from here. What was the first achievement? His first achievement was to get his article published in the Proceedings of the National Academy of Science journal. And it all started with butterflies. So this all began with his research work on butterflies. An only child, E. Bright grew up north of Reading, Pennsylvania. There wasn't much I could do there, he said. I certainly couldn't play football or baseball with a team of one. But there was one thing I could do, collect things. So here Richard E. Bright tells us that he was a single child. So that means he was the only child to his mother. And he grew up in north of Reading. Reading is the name of a place, children, in Pennsylvania. And he grew up there. And there was nothing much he could do in this place. That means he did not have many friends there. Okay. And that's the reason he jokes that he cannot play football or baseball with a team of one. All right. And then he says the only thing that he could do was to collect things because he was all alone by himself. So he did, and he did ever. Beginning in kindergarten, Ebright collected butterflies with the same determination that has marked all his activities. So from his kindergarten, what did he do, children? He started collecting butterflies, and this determination was there for throughout his life. Whatever activities he did, all those activities he did with same intensity or with same determination. He also collected rocks, fossils, and coins. So it was his hobby, children, from childhood, that is from kindergarten itself. He collected rocks, fossils, and coins. He became an eager astronomer too, sometimes stargazing all night. So one thing that he loved the most is to gaze at the stars in night. So he used to gaze at the stars all night, and that's the reason he also calls himself that he was an eager astronomer. So there were so many things he was doing as a child. Now in this paragraph, children, we are going to understand how his mother influenced his life. So let us continue. From the first, he had a driving curiosity along with a bright mind. You see, children, when somebody is very curious to know about things and with a good combination of a bright mind, then miracles can happen. So what miracles happened? Let's see. He also had a mother who encouraged his interest in learning. So he was very fortunate to have a mother who always encouraged him in learning things. She took him on trips, bought him telescopes, microscopes, cameras, mounting materials, and other equipment, and helped him in many other ways. So you see, children, this mother was always a helping hand to Richard Ebright. So she would buy many telescopes for him because he loved, you already know, children, he loved stargazing. So she bought telescopes for him. Then she bought microscope. Usually we don't buy microscopes here, right? So she bought microscopes for him so that he could study cells probably. She bought cameras, mounting materials. Mounting materials are nothing but the stands on which cameras can be put, right? So she bought mounting materials and other equipment and helped him in many other ways. So whatever Richard E. Bright wanted to do, his mother was always there for him. And she was buying things for him. I was his only companion until he started school, his mother said. After that, I would bring home friends for him. But at night, we just did things together. So you see, children, these two people were always together. His mother was always together. The only friend Richard E. Bright had as a child was his mother. And later on, she started bringing his friends home. Sometimes to spend time with him, because Richie was my whole life after his father died when Richie was in third grade. So the mother tells us that Richard E. Bright's father had died when he was in third grade. And that's the reason most of the time these two people only spend time together. She and her son spent almost every evening at the dining room table. He didn't have things to do, I found work for him. Not physical work, but learning things, his mother said. He liked it. He wanted to learn. So here you can clearly make out, children, that mother used to give him some extra work. Whenever his work was over in the evening, when his schoolwork was done, she would give him some extra learning material, because of which Richard E. Bright would do other things which are other than the academic work. And he got to learn many things from those. Now, this passage will help us understand his interest in work, you can see, children. and learn he did. He earned top grades in school. On everyday things, he was just like every other kid, his mother said. So he earned top grades in school. That is, he was very bright. Okay. By the time he was in second grade, Ebright had collected all 25 species of butterflies found around his hometown. So you see, children, by the time he was in grade 2, he had collected about 25 species of butterflies. You see, his hobby of collecting butterflies and also tabulating them was a wonderful thing that he had done. And you can see the tabular column, all the species and subspecies of butterflies that he had collected as a child in grade 2 itself. So this is quite remarkable. That probably would have been the end of my butterfly collecting, he said. But then my mother got me a children's book called The Travels of Monarch 10. That book, which told how monarch butterflies migrate to Central America, opened the world of science to the eager young collector. So Richard E. Bright says that his mother had gifted him a children's book called The Travels of Monarch 10. Monarch is nothing but one species of butterfly, children, and probably this was one 10th series of the book, and the mother had gifted him this book, which helped him to read about butterflies, right? His hobby was finding out different species of butterflies and reading about them. And when the mother gifted him this book, it actually opened a completely new door for him, where he got an opportunity to learn about various species. And he also learned how monarch butterflies migrate to Central America. So he got an opportunity to take a peek into the migration of butterflies. At the end of the book, readers were invited to help study butterfly migrations. So this book, which was brought by his mother, that is The Travels of Monarch 10, had a request from the scientists that they should also take part in the study on butterflies migrations. They were asked to tag butterflies for research by Dr. Frederick A. Urquhart of University of Toronto of Canada. So who had written this book, children? Frederick A. Urquhart has written this book, and he had requested other people to take part in this research work. Ebright's mother wrote to Dr. Urquhart, and soon Ebright was attaching light adhesive tags to the wings of the monarchs. So immediately, what did Ebright's mother do? She wrote a letter to Dr. Urquhart, and she requested that Ebright would take part in this research work. And very soon he started attaching tags. Tag is nothing but putting an identification sticker on the butterfly to know where it was traveling, right? Anyone who found a tagged butterfly was asked to send the tag to Dr. Urquhart. So after these people attach the sticker and leave the butterfly, and if it is found by anyone, they should take the tag from the butterfly and send it to Dr. Urquhart. So that was the request to all. The butterfly collecting season around Reading lasts 6 weeks in late summer. So in the place called Reading, in summer season, the collecting of butterflies was only for 6 weeks. If you're going to chase them one by one, you won't catch very many. So the next step for Ebright was to raise a flock of butterflies. So since they wouldn't be in a position to catch hold of butterflies because the season lasted only for 6 weeks in Reading, he decided to raise butterflies on his own. Okay. So what he did, he would catch a female monarch, take her eggs and raise them in his basement through their life cycle from egg to caterpillar to pupa to adult butterfly. So you see, children, what Richard Ebright did, he started collecting female monarch butterflies. Then he raised them in his basement, right? And he observed the entire life cycle of it from egg to caterpillar to pupa and until it turned to an adult butterfly. Then he would tag the butterfly's wings and let them go. So after they were adult, he used to put on the adhesive sticker on it or tag the butterfly and let them fly away. For several years, his basement was home to thousands of monarchs in different stages of development. So you can see, children, with how much determination he was working. His basement was filled with butterflies of different stages, which were in different stages. And he observed them very keenly and very closely. And he tabulated them in the form of a graph. You can see different varieties of butterflies and how they were grown. Okay, all these observations were tabulated too. Eventually, I began to lose interest in tagging butterflies. It's tedious and there's not much feedback. So Richard Ebert says, eventually he lost interest in this tagging of butterflies because he felt it was very tedious, because it was very hard work, he says, and there was not much feedback related to it. Ebright said, in all the time I did it, he laughed, only two butterflies I had tagged were recaptured and they were not more than 75 miles from where I lived. So Richard Ebright jokingly says that he was able to recapture only two butterflies which he had left, which hardly had traveled 75 miles away from his home. And there was nothing much to read about these butterflies. So he found it very boring and he decided to stop collecting butterflies. Now, children, in this paragraph, we will understand how fiercely competitive Richard Ebright became. So let's see. Then in the seventh grade, he got a hint of what real science is when he entered a county science fair and lost. So when Richard Ebright came to seventh grade, children, there was a science exhibition or a science fair in their locality. County is nothing but locality. And when he went to the science fair, he lost there. That means he did not win any prize. It was really a sad feeling to sit there and not get anything while everybody else had won something, Ebright said. So Ebright felt extremely sad because all his friends had actually won some prize or the other, but his project did not win any prize. His entry was slides of frog tissues, which he showed under a microscope. He realized the winners had tried to do real experiments, not simply make a neat display. So what was Richard Ebright's project? That he neatly took the frog's tissue and he showed it under a microscope. So nothing much was happening in this project, but others had actually done some experiments due to which they had won prizes, and Richard Ebright did not get any recognition for his exhibit. Already the competitive spirit that drives Richard Ebright was appearing. I knew that for next year's fair, I would have to do a real experiment, he said. The subject I knew most about was the insect work I had been doing in the past several years. So Richard Ebright says that he was not happy with the current year's results. So he wanted to do something good for the next year's fair. And he thought that he should come up with some real experiment. Only then he would get recognition there. So what does he do, children? So he wrote to Dr. Urquhart for ideas. And back came a stack of suggestions for experiments. So what did he do? He immediately wrote letters to Dr. Urquhart about his opinion, and immediately he got several ideas from this great scientist. Those kept Ebright busy all through high school and led to prize projects in county and international science fairs. So because of the ideas that were given by Dr. Urquhart, Ebright was able to come up with many novel projects which won many prizes, not only in the county, that is in their locality, but also in international science fairs. Now, children, in these two paragraphs, we are going to discuss two important discoveries of Richard Ebright. So let's continue. For his eighth grade project, Ebright tried to find the cause of a viral disease that kills nearly all monarch caterpillars every few years. So when Richard Ebright went to eighth grade, he tried to study the viral disease which actually killed many monarch caterpillars. Okay. Ebright thought the disease might be carried by a beetle. So the most important doubt that Ebright had was that this viral disease was present in the beetles, and if the beetles were present amongst monarch caterpillars, they would eventually die. He tried raising caterpillars in the presence of beetles. I didn't get any real results, he said, but I went ahead and showed that I had tried the experiment. This time I won. So what did he do? Richard Ebright raised monarch caterpillars in the presence of beetle, and there was no change in the lifespan of monarch caterpillars. Eventually, he was successful to prove that beetles were not the reason for the death of monarch caterpillars. So this was an important discovery. Hence, he won a prize for that. Now, the second discovery that Richard Ebright did was the next year, that is when he was in ninth grade, his science fair project was testing the theory that viceroy butterflies copy monarchs. The theory was that viceroys look like monarchs because monarchs don't taste good to birds. Viceroys, on the other hand, do taste good to birds. So the more they look like monarchs, the less likely they are to become a bird's dinner. So you can look at the picture here, children. There are two varieties of butterflies. This one is monarch and the lower one, the bottom one is viceroy. And it was proven by Richard Ebright that viceroy butterfly mimicked monarch, or it copied monarch, so that it could avoid being eaten away by birds. Certain variety of birds like starlin enjoyed eating viceroy butterflies. Okay, and they disliked monarch because they did not taste good. So what did viceroy butterflies did was they started mimicking monarch butterflies to be avoided eaten by the starling bird. So this was an important discovery by Richard Ebright. Ebright's project was to see whether, in fact, birds would eat monarchs. He found that a starling would not eat ordinary bird food. Starling is a variety of bird which did not eat bird food. It would eat all the monarchs it would get. Ebright said later, research by other people showed that viceroys probably do copy monarchs. So he proved that viceroy type of butterflies actually copied monarch to be avoided being killed by the starling birds. Now, this project was placed first in the zoology division. So in the zoology division, children, this project won first prize, not only that, and third overall in the county's science fair. And it got an third place in the overall county science fair. So this was quite prestigious, or it was a huge achievement for Richard Ebright. So when someone studies insects, what is that called, children? It's called as entomology. Study of insects is called as entomology. Now let's continue. In his second year in high school, Richard Ebright began the research that led to his discovery of an unknown insect hormone. Indirectly, it also led to his new theory on the life of cells. So he wanted to study certain insect hormones later on, which also led to his discovery about theory on the life of cells, which is very important. The question he tried to answer was simple. What is the purpose of the 12 tiny gold spots on a monarch pupa? So children, Richard Ebright noticed that when monarch butterflies pupal stage, there were about 12 tiny golden spots on them. And he wondered what were the reason for these spots to be present on the butterflies. Was it only ornamental, or was there any specific purpose for it? Everyone assumed the spots were just ornamental, Ebright said. But Dr. Yukhart didn't believe it. To find the answer, Ebright and another excellent science student first had to build a device that showed that the spots were producing a hormone necessary for the butterfly's full development. So these people did not believe, that is Richard Ebright and Dr. Yukhart, both of them did not believe that these spots which were present on the butterfly were ornamental. They thought that there was some specific purpose for the presence of orange spots. And they started studying it. And eventually, they were able to prove that these spots were producing certain kind of hormones in the butterfly, which was necessary for growth and development of the butterflies. This project won Ebright first place in the county fair and entry into the international fair and engineering fair. There he won third place for zoology. He also got a chance to work during the summer at the entomology laboratory of the Walter Reed Army Institute of Research. So this particular discovery, that is the spots on the butterfly were producing certain hormones in monarch butterflies, was an important discovery. Hence, he won many prizes in county fair, and also he got an entry into the international science fair and engineering fair. And this also got him an opportunity to get into entomology laboratory, that is Walter Reed Army Institute of Research. Children, here it's not easy to get into this particular laboratory, but Ebright got the opportunity to get into it to do his research work. As a high school junior, Richard Ebright continues his advanced experiments on the monarch pupa. That year, his project won first place at the International Science Fair and gave him another chance to work in the Army laboratory during the summer. So he continued working on the monarch pupa and he got a prize in the International Science Fair. He won first place and that got him an opportunity to work in the laboratory that summer. In his senior year, he went a step further. He grew cells from a monarch's wing in a culture and showed that the cells would divide and develop into normal butterfly wing scales only if they were fed the hormone from the gold spots. So you see, children, this is very important. He was able to identify that the hormones were responsible for growth and development in the butterflies. That project won first place for zoology at the International Fair. He spent the summer after graduation doing further work at the Army Laboratory and at the laboratory of the U.S. Department of Agriculture. So one after the other, he got an opportunity to work in all the great laboratories of America. He went on to work in the Army Laboratory, followed by the laboratory of U.S. Department of Agriculture, so which itself is very prestigious. The following summer, after his freshman year at Harvard University, Ebright went back to the laboratory of the Department of Agriculture and did more work on the hormone from the gold spots. Using the laboratory's sophisticated instruments, he was able to identify the hormone's chemical structure. So in these labs, because of the advanced instruments, he was able to identify the chemical structure of the hormones, children. A year and a half later, during his junior year, Ebright got the idea for his new theory about cell life. It came while he was looking at X-ray photos of the chemical structure of a hormone. So he actually did in-depth study about the cell life and he got certain idea when he was looking at the X-ray photos of the chemical structure of a hormone. So this is very significant, children. You have to remember that he discovered the theory about cell life, okay? And after this theory, the author says, when he saw those photos, Ebright didn't shout Eureka or even I have got it. But he believed that along with his findings about insect hormones, the photos gave him the answer to one of the biology's puzzles, how the cell can read the blueprint of its DNA. So children, when this discovery was made, he did not shout Eureka. Eureka is nothing but the cry of joy. You all know about Archimedes, how he ran into the streets naked when he discovered that gold was heavier than silver, if you remember that, right? But Richard Ebright was not like that. He did not shout Eureka or he did not say, I got it. But he believed, what did he believe? That his findings about insect hormones, the photos gave him the answer to the one of the biology's puzzles. That is, this was very puzzling to the scientists and he got answer to the question. What was the question? How the cell can read the blueprint of its DNA? So you all know, children, DNA is deoxyribonucleic acid, which is the genetic material inside the cell and which carries the genetic information, right? And Ebright was able to understand how the cell is reading its DNA, right? And DNA is the substance in the nucleus of a cell that controls heredity. It determines the form and function of the cell. Thus, DNA is the blueprint for life. So he was able to understand how the cell was reading its DNA. So this is also very important, which you have to keep in mind. Ebright and his college roommate, James R. Wong, worked all that night drawing pictures and constructing plastic models of molecules to show how it could happen. Together, they later wrote the paper that explained the theory. So children, Richard Ebright, along with his roommate, that is James R. Wong, they actually drew many pictures talking about the structure. And they also made plastic models of it so that they could explain it to others. And they wrote a paper on it, on this theory. And these scientific papers are very important because It is read by millions of people across the world. Surprising, no one knew him. Richard E. Bright graduated from Harvard with highest honors, second in his class of 1,510. E. Bright went on to become a graduate student researcher at Harvard Medical School. There he began doing experiments to test his theory. So Richard E. Bright was very bright children. He went on to do his honors in Harvard University, which is very prestigious university in US. And he also became a very important student researcher in Harvard Medical School, where he began to do several experiments to test his theory. If the theory proves correct, it will be a big step towards understanding the processes of life. It might also lead to new ideas for preventing some types of cancer and other diseases. So children, his discovery was very important because it helped in understanding the processes of life, and it also became a foundation for understanding the prevention of some few types of cancer and few other diseases. All of this is possible because of E. Bright's scientific curiosity. So the author says it was very important because of his scientific curiosity, all this was possible. His high school research into the purpose of the spots on a monarch pupa eventually led him to his theory about cell life. Richard E. Bright has been interested in science since he first began collecting butterflies, but not so deeply that he hasn't time for other interests. So in this paragraph, we are going to see what are the other things that Richard E. Bright did. Children, apart from doing research work, he was a champion debater, a public speaker, and a good canoeist, an all-around outdoors person. So what did Richard E. Bright do? He would debate very well. That means he was a very good public speaker and he was a very good canoeist. Canoeist, nothing but rowing the boat. He was very good at it and he was mostly an outdoor person. He is also an expert photographer, particularly of nature and scientific exhibits. So he was also a very important photographer, children. He was very good at it. He usually photographed nature and other scientific exhibits. In high school, Richard E. Bright was a straight A student because learning was easy. He turned a lot of his energy towards debating and model United Nations Club. So Richard E. Bright showed a lot of interest in debating and also in model United Nations Clubs. He also found someone to admire, Richard A. Wehrer, his social studies teacher and advisor to both clubs. Mr. Wehrer was the perfect person for me then. He opened my mind to new ideas, E. Bright said. So now we are introduced to his social science teacher, that is Mr. Wehrer, who was a person who inspired E. Bright. Start with the first rate mind, add curiosity and mix in the will to win for the right reason. So Mr. Wehrer says, but that one should have first rate mind, that is mind of highest quality, right? And you should add curiosity to it and mix it with will. Will is nothing but grit or determination to win for the right reasons. E. Bright has these qualities. From the time the book, The Travels of Monarch 10, opened the world of science to him, Richard E. Bright has never lost his scientific curiosity. So from the time Richard E. Bright received the book called The Travels of Monarch 10, Richard E. Bright maintained his scientific curiosity. This curiosity never died down. And with this, we have come to an end of this session, children. I'm ending the session.